Hello everyone, the topic is peri-implantitis. Now this is a very important question in your exams which is commonly asked, and this is from the topic that is implants. So what is peri-implantitis? So peri, it means around. Implant is your implants. So peri is around the implants, and itis is nothing but inflammation. So it means it is inflammation which is present around the implant. So over here, this is your implant. So the inflammation which is present around the implant, it is known as peri-implantitis. Now it was introduced in the year 1987. So peri-implantitis, it is an infectious disease that causes the inflammation of the gum and the bone structures which is present around the dental implant. Now as there is inflammation which is present around the implant, so because of that there can be bone loss which you will see, and this will lead to the loose implant. Now we know in implant, so this implant, it is integrated to the bone. So this implant, it is fixed, or it is getting that support from the adjacent bone. So if there is bone loss, so eventually your implants, it will get loosed and it will fall out. So the peri-implant disease, it will cause bone loss around the implant, and there is loss of osseointegration, which means your implant, it is going to get out of that socket and it is going to get fallout. So the definition for peri-implantitis is, it is a progressive peri-implant bone loss. So it is progressive around the implant, the bone loss in conjugation with the soft tissue inflammatory lesion. Now in this you will see the bone loss, and with that you will see the soft tissue inflammation, that is the inflammation of the gum. Now what is the etiology of it? So the etiology, it is multifactorial. So there are three factors for the etiology of this peri-implantitis. So it can be microbial factors, that means it is because of the bacteria. The next can be the biological factor. So biological factor is the factors of the host, that is the humans. And there can be mechanical factors. Mechanical factors is for the implants. So microbial are because of the bacteria. So the bacteria which is involved in the inflammation of the peri-implant, so it can be the gram-negative anaerobes, then Fusobacterium spirochetes, and a black pigmented organism that can be Prevotella intermedia. So these are like the organisms which are causing peri-implantitis. Now what are these biological factors? Biological factors are the host factors. So it can be the implant rejection. Now implant, it is made up of titanium usually. So there are chances that the human, that is the host, it does not accept the implant and it act. So this implant, it is acted as a foreign body. So because of that, there are chances that there can be inflammation around that implant, in which the implant, it is rejected by the host. The next can be the systemic status of the patient. If the patient's health, it is compromised, so in that case also, there can be peri-implantitis. The next etiological factor, it can be the habits of the patient. So if the patient, he is a chronic smoker, so in that case, it can lead to the inflammation of the peri-implant. The next etiological factor is the improper adaptation of the implant to the bone. So if your bone, it is not properly adapted to the implant, so in that case also you will see there is peri-implantitis. Now what are the mechanical factors? So that means what are the factors which are related to the implant. So in that case, first is the heavy occlusal forces. Now in this diagram, so this is your implant, this is your tooth, that is the crown, and this is the screw or the implant. So when the forces are applied, so if the occlusal forces, they are too much, so if there are excessive forces, so it may lead to high stress, or it can lead to the microfracture in the coronal bone to implant contact, and thus it leads to the loss of osseointegration around this neck of implant. So this can be the reason, etiological. If there are forces, so it can lead to the microfracture of this implant. The next can be the abutment in the traumatic occlusion. So if the occlusion is not in harmonious relation, so it can lead to peri-implantitis. And the next can be improper selection, design, and the placement. If the implant, it is not selected properly, if it is not designed properly, or if it is not placed properly, so it can lead to peri-implantitis. So these are the etiological factors for peri-implantitis. Now what is the clinical features? So in this, it begins at the coronal portion of the implant, while the apical portion, it remains the osseointegrated. Now when the peri-implantitis, it starts, so it starts in the coronal portion, whereas there is bone loss. Firstly, you'll see there is bone loss in the coronal portion, whereas your implant, it is osseointegrated, that means it is integrated properly to the bone in the apical portion. The next is, you'll see there is color change. There can be bleeding on the genital probing. So when you're probing, so there will be bleeding. Then there can be suppuration. So it can lead to pus formation. Then there can be calculus buildup and swelling. Now there is bone loss. So there is space which is present over here. So there will be calculus deposition in this area and there can be swelling. The next can be pocket formation. Now as there is calculus buildup, so it will lead to pocket formation. And you will see there is radiographic bone destruction. So peri-implantitis is nothing basically, but it is the destruction of the bone. So you will see radiographic bone destruction. The next is mobility. It has been extensively described to detect the early and the late failures. Now the implants. So basically the implants, they have good success rate. But there are chances where the implants, they can fail. So your implants, they have early and the late failures. Early, it can be at the surgery only. And late is nothing but due to this peri-implantitis. So if there is peri-implantitis, it will lead to the failure of your implant. And the next is the fistula. It may be present in more chronic cases. So these are the clinical features. Now the next is the classification, like how it is classified. So it is basically classified into four classes. So class one is where you will see there is slight horizontal bone loss. So peri-implantitis, we have seen there is progressive bone loss. So in this first class, you will see the bone loss, it is very slight. Now over here you can see there is very slight horizontal bone loss and there will be very minimal peri-implant defect. So around your implant, there will be very minimal defect. Now in class two, you'll see there is moderate horizontal bone loss. Over here it is slight. Over here now you can see it is a moderate bone loss and there will be isolated vertical defect around the implant. Now in class 3 it will be moderate to advanced horizontal bone loss and there will be broad circular bony defect. So around your implant there will be circular defect which you will see. And class 4 is the worst case in which there is advanced horizontal bone loss with broad circumferential vertical defect. As well as you will see there is loss of the oral or the vestibular bony walls. So this is the class 4 which has the worst prognosis. Now how are you going to diagnose the peri-implantitis? So basically there are three ways in which you can diagnose it. So it can be probing, radiograph or the microbial monitoring. Now we have seen in the etiological factor that the microorganisms can cause peri-implantitis. So in this microbial monitoring, so it is useful in evaluating the peri-implant health and the condition and the microbial composition of the peri-implantitis site. So which are the microorganisms which are involved? We can see that by the microbial monitoring. The next can be the radiograph. So it reveals the peri-implant bone status as well as the marginal bone level. Now in periapical intraoral radiographs, they are obtained instead of the OPGs because periapical, as the name says, you can see the bone in the periapical radiograph in a much better way than your OPGs. So we are using periapical radiograph rather than OPGs. And in this, now peri-implantitis is the bone loss. So in this radiograph, you will see exactly how much the bone loss is around the implant. And in this probing is successful implant. Generally, it allows the probe penetration of approximately 3 to 4 mm and the location of the peri-implant bone level, it can be expected to be about 1 mm apical to the position of your probe tip. So if there is successful implant which is done, so in that case you will see when you're probing, so you will see there is normal 3 to 4 mm probing depth. But if the probing depth it is increased, so in that case you can diagnose that it can be peri-implantitis. And the last part of this is the management. How are you going to manage the peri-implantitis? It can be divided into three phases. That can be occlusal therapy. So we have seen in the etiological factor that because of heavy or excessive occlusal forces, it can lead to peri-implantitis. So it is the occlusal therapy. And the next can be the non-surgical therapy. And the last one is the surgical therapy. So if the disease, it is very progressed. So in that case, you have to go for the surgical therapy. So what is about the occlusal therapy? So when the excessive forces, they are considered the main etiological factor, the treatment, it involves the analysis of the fit of the prosthesis. So if you think that there is excessive forces, which is the reason for peri-implantitis, what you're going to do is you're first going to analyze about the fit of the prosthesis, like whether your implant it is fitted properly or not. Then the change in the prosthesis design, improvement of the implant number, position and the occlusal equilibration, it can contribute to arrest the progression of the peri-implant tissue breakdown. So what you can do is if you see about the fit, so in that you can do the changes in the design of it. You can change the number, you can change the position and you can do the occlusion equilibrium. Next is the non-surgical therapy. So in this, local removal of the plaque. So if now we have seen in the clinical features, there is calculus buildup. So first you are going to remove the plaque with the plastic instrument. Now your implants, they are made up of titanium. So if you are using steel instrument in that case, so it will abrade the implant. So in that case, you are using the plastic instruments and polishing of all the accessible surfaces with the pumice is done. So first you are removing whatever the plaque is. Then the subgingival irrigation of all the peri-implant pocket is done. So if there is pocket formation now, as we have seen in the clinical features, so there are pocket formation. So what you are going to do is you are irrigating it with 0.12% chlorhexidine. And you're going to keep the patient on systemic antimicrobial therapy for 10 consecutive days. So this is about the first thing. The next is the improved patient compliance with oral hygiene. So the patient, they are instructed to maintain good oral hygiene. The next is conventional hand and the ultrasonic instrument, they are not suitable for the preparation and detoxification of the implant surface. And the next is irradiation with the soft lasers for the elimination of the bacteria. So you can also use lasers in this case to eradicate whatever the bacteria or to eliminate the bacteria. And the last is the surgical therapy. So once the inflammatory process in the peri-implant tissue is under control, an attempt it can be made to improve or re-establish the osseointegration. Now in peri-implantitis, there is loss of osseointegration. So once you see that the inflammatory process, so there is the inflammation which is present. So first you are going to control that inflammation. So once you see that the inflammation, it is in control. So then you're going to make attempt to get that osseointegration re-established. So the surgical procedures, they are modified from the techniques which I use to treat the bone defects around the teeth. So it can be resective or regenerative osseous surgeries. So you are going to do that surgical procedures in the case for the surgical therapy when you see that the inflammation is in control, and after that you are going to re-establish the osseointegration. So you go for resective or regenerative. Regenerative, it can be with the help of grafts or something. So this is the surgical therapy. So this was all about the peri-implantitis. Now you should know this answer very well because it is very, very commonly asked in your exams. So this was all about it. I hope you found this video helpful, and if you did, then please like, comment. If you have any doubts, do share it with your friends and do subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much.